doing things that would achieve better outcomes for people in the forest on the ground, that they entrusted me with that task. So the first thing I did when I put together my team of people was that I didn't just hire foresters and sort of cultures to keep what they already expected I would do. I hired economists, anthropologists, agronomists, foresters, ecologists, a whole lot of people from the different disciplines I thought were relevant to those problems. And then the second thing I did was to interpret the offer of the Indonesian government to give us a research forest to work. Everybody assumed we'd take natural land in West Java and we would plant trees and do the things that foresters do in the forest, measure them, chop them down, things like that. I didn't do that. I persuaded the Indonesian government that they should give us not a forest to manage, but access to a forest to do research. And I wanted a forest that had very high biodiversity values, diversity of ethnic groups, of indigenous people, that had high value for conventional forestry, and that was likely to be radically changed over the coming decades by development, of course, all sorts of things. And so we finally settled upon a huge area of forest in what is now North Carolina. And my vision was that C4 would have its multidisciplinary team working in those forests together, and together jointly unraveling the problems of conserving those forests. And the idea was to have one such area in Indonesia, one in Africa in Congo Basin, and one in South America. Now, one of the first lessons that comes out of all this is that it's very difficult to persuade donor agencies to support this sort of thing. The sorts of people who fund C4 and other research organizations, the sorts of people who fund you when you're bidding for research funding, want things to deliver results in 2 or 3 years. They want simple, often discipline-based outcomes. And so it's been a long history, and I'll talk a bit more about this, but people trying to do this integrated landscape approach to conservation, but failing to get sustained funding to do it. Now, when I left C4, went back to being more of a practical conservationist, dealing with programs that were operated by World Wildlife Fund and the International Community of Conservation of Nature. And I became more and more frustrated at the fact that it was really difficult to get science integrated into those programs. So the science going on was relevant, but the practical day-to-day decisions about conservation programs were not taking into account all that science. So I had the opportunity to get a grant from the Carter Foundation to set up a program in Australia, in James Cook University, to do integrated science around sustainable development in eastern Indonesia. And so we did that for 8 years. And that was my first real exposure to academia, the first time I'd been employed at a university, and was subject to the sorts of pressures and incentives the universities offer. Now we move to British Columbia, which is even more of an elite university, and a very good university. But what I see now in these worlds of universities is that all the incentives, all the structures, reinforce this tendency for research to be done within disciplines. They favor discipline-based research. So we have a huge faculty of forestry in our university in Vancouver. The vast majority of people are very detailed, knowledgeable people about certain components of the systems that we're concerned with. And it's not easy in the past for people to really pursue a career looking at the complexity of science and working in big teams. So I am very enthusiastic about the fact that people should work in teams and should do interdisciplinary science, as Professor actually Kim talked about yesterday. A lot of what I'm going to say follows up on what you said yesterday, Mr. Sujin, and I'm going to try and give some practical examples of that. But I still think we face a challenge that the world has enormous environmental problems. Indonesia has enormous environmental problems, and they are not being dealt with in a very scientific way. They're subject to activism, political expediency, commercial expediency, and getting a balanced, thoughtful, interdisciplinary understanding of the nature of those problems and the solutions to those problems is a real challenge that we have to face. And I'm counting on your new interdisciplinary center here really to do that. And I and then he said, particular problem in New Central Detention. So I have a few slides just to illustrate some of the points I've made. The first one, the slide itself, the background picture, is of Camp Ministry in Rio. And this is an example of where this sort of need for interdisciplinary, holistic approaches to things is very, very evident. It's a place that I've been involved in, because I've been inviting Able, the company that operates this area. So here, in the area shown in this picture, you have people who are rather poor, who are struggling to live on fish resources, catching birds and things. They don't have easy lives. They're amongst the poor of Indonesia. You have an ecosystem that has a large number of very rare and endangered species of birds. You have peat swamps, so peat is carbon, and when you drain that peat, it oxidizes and it contributes to climate change. So there's a global issue with peat maps there. But you also have one of Indonesia's most sophisticated, state-of-the-art industries, one of the most efficient, and the biggest pulp and paper and rayon producing factories in the world, employing tens of thousands of people and making huge contributions to the economy. So this single area represents a huge array of problems, and there's no one to do about these problems. You have to draw on human behavior. Understand the people, what contributes to their livelihoods, what will be good for them in the future. You have to consider the ecosystem, what will allow the country in the future to support all those rest of the city. And you have to consider the economic system. You have to say what will be the impact on the economic system of the province, of the country, of the different decisions you might take. And I guess my message today is that I think that Indonesia is not being very good at doing that at the moment. A lot of decisions are made, again, like I said earlier, on the basis of political expediency, the interests of the companies, and advocacy, and a lot of advocacy that it's not really indigenous to Indonesia, it's sponsored by people from outside Indonesia. What I would like to see is much more engagement of scientists from different disciplines in solving this problem and many other problems in these sorts of places. So I'm going to try and sum up a little bit of the things that have been said already by Chris Marshall and some of the other people about these approaches, these interdisciplinary approaches to doing science. First of all, any science we do, in my view, these days, has to be justified by the impact it's going to have. It's got to be benefits for the environment and for people. And we have to keep focused on that. We have to really, I don't think these days, in the economic conditions in which we live, we can allow ourselves the justification of doing science purely for curiosity. We have to contribute to a better life for present and future people. We have to understand what sort of change is going on. We don't necessarily want to solve these solutions to problems. But we do want to have a good idea when we start of how our research is going to contribute to solving those problems. So that means almost by definition that we're going to have research which is interdisciplinary and it's going to have to be collaborative. So people are now talking about transdisciplinary research, which is research that is not only interdisciplinary but also involves end users of research, the people who actually take the decisions, the people whose behavior is going to influence. So the term sustainability science is also used for that sort of research. It has to be in context. Now, you can do this sort of research at any scale, from a global scale, from a very global scale, and you can do it in your lab here. What we do, and what we think is really important for Indonesia, and what we think we made a bit of progress in working out how to do, is to do it at these spatially defined areas, these smaller areas, which we call landscapes. So a landscape can be a tribal pattern, it can be a wetland area like Kampar, it can be anything, but it's an area where you have a shared set of problems and you can get people to engage you for solving the problems. I think you almost never get immediate silver bullet solutions to these problems. They evolve over time. incentives and rewards the scientists don't really encourage them to do that. They engage in these difficult, messy, underground situations for a long time. And it's really important that the world of science changes. And again, I come back to your interdisciplinary center here. I think that's a move in the right direction. And I've seen over the last couple of decades a whole lot of new journals that are coming out called Conservation Society, Ecology Society, Sustainability Science, Sustainability. There's a whole lot of them that are recognizing and specializing this sort of integrated type of research. So that's why I'd like to see us all together publishing. So another little reflection on how science is organized, particularly science funded by aid agencies. I don't care very much about aid agencies, which will gather after a time. But I don't know if you're familiar with this term, whining moles, but it's a game that goes on in arcades, apparently in America. A little mole appears out of a hole, and you hit it with a hammer, and they come faster and faster, and you have to hit them as quickly as you can. So now, political scientists and economists are using this term to describe the sort of reactive science that goes on in the world, where scientists run after one issue and then something another issue comes up and they go on after that. That's exactly what's been happening in the forest sector in Indonesia for the last 20 years. We've gone through a whole series of things where the main burden is for the answer to the problem was eco-labeling. For 2 or 3 years everybody does that, and then everybody does law enforcement and governments for 2 years. And then it's red still, everybody's doing red. And things like high conservation value and high carbon stocks come in, they absorb people's attention. Now it's getting companies to engage with zero deforestation. This is not what we need. We need a balanced, holistic, continuous understanding of how forests are evolving. And we need a central agency, the Ministry of Forestry, who takes into account all these sorts of things and doesn't jump from one issue to another and respond to sort of populist things. So, again, to go back to Professor Sogin's presentation yesterday about how these scientists teams work. We've used this as an analogy in these cartoons to argue that integrated science is like jazz. It's not programmed, it's not a detailed sort of top-down structure. In this particular picture, we have a conductor, but maybe he shouldn't be there. It should be that the people are communicating horizontally amongst themselves, responding to what the other people are doing, and it's not a planned process. It's all empathy and knowing each other and stuff like that. So that's what I see interdisciplinary science as being. Multidisciplinary science is where you have a symphony orchestra where the violins do one thing, the drums do something else, and the trumpets do something else, and suddenly the front makes your sound group. So this is the sort of level of integration we're talking about in interdisciplinary science. Okay, so the situation, the sort of generic situation we're dealing with in Indonesia is people who are poor, so we, lots of people are not poor, we haven't been applying our work in those areas, we're talking about places where people are poor and struggling to survive, but places where there is very high biodiversity, very high levels of biodiversity. And I think there's a lot more to be said about the things that Chris wrote about setting priorities for conservation in Indonesia. The present system of protected areas is probably not sustainable in the long run, and it wouldn't stand up to careful examination of these sorts of criteria that Chris has set up. So we have to understand its biodiversity, understand the livelihoods of those people. And I think the sustainable development goals provide a little of a framework that you can use in engaging with these situations, with these landscapes, because you want to deliver on all these comfortable conventions of conservation development in a geographical area. So that's the sort of thing that we're trying to do in our research. And I'll just give you one or two examples, but basically what I'm saying, we would like to do this with your interdisciplinary center, with you, in the field, in different places. So I know this is not really new. Other people in the past have wanted to do integrated long-term research in the forest areas of Indonesia. The fact that that's failed to happen is worrying. So this is a partial map that attempts to set up major field laboratories, field research stations to deal with biodiversity conservation. Because the paper's original work was in observation and represented the overblown international park. In 1983, at the time, the World Bank invested seriously in conservation anywhere. Millions of dollars went into a very elaborate, luxurious research station. If you're paying taxes in Indonesia, you're probably still paying for that, the World Bank. And it never functioned. People never went into research on anything like the scale that was anticipated. It happened at the end here in the 1990s, we back to Raya, USA, and the International Tropical Timber Organization put in millions of dollars to build a very elaborate research center to deal with the integrated problems on the heart of Borneo. That place has never functioned. I don't think any research has ever been done there. All those other places were attempts to set up long-term integrated research programs, and they didn't really succeed. Some succeeded a bit better than others. So this one here is the thing that we set up in Seawall, and that was almost 20 years ago, and it worked reasonably well for a time. After I left Seawall very difficult, didn't continue getting funding for that. Again, the donors weren't interested in these rather incremental, large-scale, long-term things. They wanted short-term solutions. They wanted the Seawall to go around packing holes. So Seawall would be dumping from red to government to everything else, because that's what the donors thought of priorities. So anyway, the fact that I'm saying this now is not totally new. People have appreciated this for a long time, but they built these facilities. What they haven't done is mobilize the scientists who are working on, provide the incentives for the scientists, the career pathways for scientists to work on these sort of practical and interdisciplinary problems. So, in our humble way, with our little team from Australia and from UBC Canada, we've been trying to focus on a small number of landscapes where we go back every year and work. And we have not tried to build an elaborate infrastructure and research centers. We simply stay with local people, we work with local universities, we work with local NGOs and government, and we're seeking to build broader collaboration with University of Indonesia and others in these places and maybe some other places. And I'll just run through a few examples of some of the things that have come out of this sort of collaborative research. So, oil palm is a very controversial issue. People take strong positions. Some people want to abolish oil palm from the face of the earth. Other people say it should solve all their problems. So we brought together a small multidisciplinary team, and we tried to lend a more balanced view of the issues around oil palm, how in the right way, in the right place, with the right governance, can be a very useful crop that provides livelihoods for people, and you can do it in ways that do maintain. So that's one example. In North Sulawesi, the whole mangrove group, the tree crops, the nutmeg, cloves, and things like that. There's lots of things, lots of issues around the sustainable management of those sorts of things, issues around the extent to which government controls it, the extent to which the private sector is there. So some really interesting issues here for supporting people's livelihoods, conserving, extending natural forests, and driving economic growth. There are big issues around mining in Indonesia. So I was trying to look at the other presentations, but the last presentation with all those minerals, except that most of those minerals are dug up in the places where we are working in the field. We're building roads into our forests in order to access all those rare minerals. Anyway, that's a big issue in Indonesia. Either in favor of industrial mining or in favor of small scale mining, and opinions are very polarized. And James, who's with us today, this is an interesting work showing that it's not as simple as that. There are some very positive things about artisanal mining, as well as some negative things, and there are some positive things about industrial mining, although the profits tend to go to shareholders in London or Ottawa or Sydney. So, again, they're complex issues that require platform. Another example is in the drier parts of NTT, where you've got big conflicts between local people and their livelihoods and the need to conserve forests on steep slopes to protect watersheds. OneNote, my thinking on these things, you can find lots of publications about it that explain in much more detail how you do these things and how you measure success, all those sorts of things. I try to sum up what I think are the real challenges that this group needs to face today, and the interdisciplinary center needs to face as it evolves. I think some of the key things, and I think Professor Kim said this yesterday, is that you have to have a shared understanding of the problem. You don't have a different problem for each discipline. You have to get your people together to work out what the problem is. That problem has to be defined with people who are on the ground working in the system. Obviously, you need these interdisciplinary or transdisciplinary teams. The question of facilitational leadership was discussed with me yesterday, and I am still unsure of that, because you don't want these characters to dominate everything and don't give anybody any flexibility to be adaptable or to have different views, but you do need a degree of leadership to make the whole thing hang together. So I think that's something where the jury is still out. How are these things led? So we've come up with this concept of peripheral agents, people who are influential but are not charismatic leaders, who are there on the sidelines to try and make things happen, but are not in charge of the process. I think these things have to be done in the field. I think the nature of the problem in Indonesia now does mean that people have to be out there, in the field, in the forest, on the coastlines, working for long periods in remote areas where the problems are found. So they have to be really embedded in that context. So we want to have not just scientists, we want to have practitioners, people from forestry, from different government EASs, and local people involved in these processes so that we influence their thinking, but they also influence our thinking with their knowledge. So citizen science, again, local citizens, they know much more about the complexity of local situations than we do. And it is all finally about changing the behavior of people, changing the behavior of ministers, of companies, of villagers, of local government. And we have to understand what determines their behavior and how we might influence it. We have a doctoral student working on that in Indonesia. We have to communicate it. We have to make sure people know what we are finding, that the information goes to the people whose decisions will determine the outcomes. There's a lot written. This paper here, this set of papers, you can do all these things, you've got a long memory stick, but it sets out in much more detail how you can do these things in a landscape. There's a couple of papers that have come out in the last few months, again, we have a long memory sticks, which question the fact that these international processes are getting more and more detached from the realities on the ground, and the people in Paris and the COPs and in all these international gatherings, the politicians who go there, they don't know much about what's happening on the ground, and they come up with simple solutions to our very complex problems. We think that's harmful, so we could think about that. And we've also written, and you might talk more about this, about the need for this science to be located in the field, to be connected to policy processes, to be connected to local people, and to really dealing with solving practical problems. And that's what I'm going to overview. And now my three colleagues, Diane Lickwood, can say a little bit about some of the practical things, which are sort of practical work out towards local level. So, and I hand over to